Welcome, you're listening to The Best of Investing on Talk 910, the show where we present valuable information about real estate, the financial markets, and other economic business of the day. We've got some really interesting articles to talk about today. I'm your host, Edward Brown, and I'm proud to have as my co-host, Mark Hanf of Pacific Private Money, California's fastest growing mortgage investment firm. And Mark's going to tell us later on of some of the awesome deals he's working on. And Rob Spinoza of RPM Mortgage, and he's going to talk about the awesome deals he's been working on. Okay, our phone number is 888-912-1190. Use that number to answer the trivia questions for three vacations given away during each commercial break. That's right, we're giving away nine vacations. And today's trivia theme, everyone perks up on that, is astronomy.
Astronomy.
Carl Sagan.
No. How many moons does the Earth have? One. Okay, that's it. That's it for it. Okay.
Pluto's not a planet anymore.
I know.
That's what it was.
Yeah. You know what? I think personally they just did that just to make, to be different.
Change the textbooks.
Yeah. That's it. The guy who writes the textbook says, change it, please. I need to get more publishing there. Mm-hmm. Okay, our website's bestofinvesting.com. Check us out on Facebook and YouTube. Also on television with Mr. Kramer here broadcasting us on the channel, Comcast Channel 26. And AT&T Channel 99, Saturdays noon, Sundays at 6 p.m. All right, Mark, you've got some very interesting statistics and an article.
Well, yeah, and being a real estate guy, I'm always on the hunt for something new and noteworthy in real estate. And over the last couple of months, we've just been talking about some of the more boring stuff in real estate. Prices are up, inventory's down, so what else is new? Are prices going to continue to rise through 2014? Are they going to go down in 2015, as some people are predicting, or a few people, I should say, because not a whole lot are. But here's an article I found that I thought was interesting. Those millennials, those guys that are all working in tech now.
Those aren't Klingons.
No,
that's Star Trek. Okay, millennials.
The millennials, those are the 20 to 30 year olds. And here was a survey that was done on the type, what are they looking for in a home? So, you and I, Edward, were in baby boomer.
Speak for yourself.
Generation here. Well, we're the youngest.
The younger part.
The younger part of the curve. The end of the curve there of the baby boomers. And I know what we tend to look at. There was the saying location, 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 which oftentimes equated to a nice quiet neighborhood with a nice yard and close to schools. Schools being the big one. Well, millennials for the most part don't give a hoot about schools. They're not looking for that.
Some of them wanted to be near the Google box.
Yeah, but when I was first looking for a house, I was just looking for indoor plumbing. Okay, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, they're looking for that and more, because they're looking for more. It's functionality and lifestyle are more important to Gen Y than the size of the home or the actual property. So they're looking for things like, a top-notch kitchen where they can entertain their guests in, and they're less likely to look for a large yard because they're busy. And they're too busy for a yard and too busy for fixer-uppers.
A quick question about the schools part of it. I wonder how many are looking at private schools. And so it doesn't really matter as much.
I see that being a continued dilemma where you're looking at maybe buying a lesser house and putting the kids in private school, or buying a house in a nicer area and then putting them in the public schools. It seems to be the age-old thing. Yeah.
I think the schools are still important as they get older. So we're talking about Gen Y, which is 20 to 30. When you're in the 30 to 40 and you're starting to go, well, now it's time to have kids, I think still the location and the school areas. But just an interesting kind of a rundown. They're looking for homes with little or no work needed. Many of them don't have time to tackle a fixer. Again, they don't see a large yard as a plus. And really, they're looking at being closer to the social scene. They like public transportation, close to trendy shops, and closeness proximity to work. Those are all things that.
Well, let me ask you then. What about condos? Then I would think you're kind of describing that a condo type living that would be going up.
I see a lot of that in the city, San Francisco, and Oakland even as well. I mean, condos in the Emeryville area, a lot of those areas where they've rebuilt, a lot of interest in that. And the thing I see too with buyers is that when you see them attempting to get into a fixer, that is the discussion I'll have with them, is let alone the financing component of it, trying to finance something that may require a lot of work. But a lot of these people don't have the time and energy to do it. Mm-hmm. So, that's the other consideration when you're buying a fixer.
Yep, absolutely. And then a different article from a different publication, which kind of dovetails a little bit. It's one thing to know the type of home that they want, but there's also, and this is something we talked about before, I'm looking at a chart here that shows how student debt has actually hampered first-time home buyers. So that same Gen Y millennials group, you know, those that are buying, of course, are looking for the types of properties we just talked about.
And aren't they changing the interest rate too?
I'm not familiar with that. Yeah.
Yeah, the government just changed the interest rate, increasing it, of course.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh gosh, that's great. Let's help. Yeah. We're the government, and we're here to help. But interesting graph. I mean, they charted two, and of course you can't see this because it's radio. But the graph for both 25 to 29 year olds and 30 to 34 year olds. Now I don't know why they picked those separately, but they're both trending downward since peaking in 2004. So basically it's been tracking downward and has not started to go up yet in this so-called recovery for that age range of 25 to, I guess, 34 year olds. And they're saying that that in large part is due to growing student debt.
And turn that piece of paper around so Kramer can put it on TV.
Well, too, I would say that also coincides with the change in mortgage lending guidelines that happened around 2006, 2007, because you would not see reflected in those stats, my guess, or it would be very hard to separate in those stats, the fact that the, you know, some of those individuals, if they were saddled with that student loan debt then, 2004, 2005, they may have been able to find a loan product that would have enabled them to qualify with it anyway. Now, in the full doc environment with the CFPB requirements for debt to income, it becomes harder and harder to clear that hurdle when you pull a credit report and that student loan debt is staring you right in the face. There's no way around it.
Well,
yeah.
Yeah, with all the tuition as high as it is, you know, the student debt load.
Yes.
Because the interest
yes.
rate, just the load is just too high.
And I think, you know, a tougher job market has also been a component of that. So you have some people who have studied very diligently, they've graduated college, gone out and found no luck in the job market. What do? A lot of them go back to school and at an expense. So,
you know, just add to the debt. And when they come out, they got to start at $250,000 a year just to pay the
correct.
The interest.
You're not joking around. And it goes back to what Mark said,
never
too.
Joke around.
If you come out of school and you're 24, you know, you may not be interested in buying a house right away. Okay, I can rent a bit, my lifestyle's a little bit more low-key. But when you come out of school, quote-unquote out of school, and you're pushing 30 and you're thinking of starting a family, that's a different story. Now you're looking for a different property in a different area with different criteria, and you fall right into the crosshairs of this.
Tell you what, we're going to cut to a first commercial break here. Again, the theme is astronomy. And when we come back, I want you to share an article about the CF.
Okay. Consumer Financial Protection Bureau.
There you go. Yeah. That's a mouthful. Okay, because that one's kind of interesting. Audience, you're going to want to stay tuned because you're not going to believe what is out there. Okay, here is the first astronomy question. What is the name of the hazy band of light that arcs across the clear night sky? All right.
Are you supposed to be, do you need to be on LSD in order to see that?
No, but it has to be a clear night, though.
Okay.
All right, make sure to include your name and your email address. Speak slowly, spell out your email one letter at a time. Make sure you stay tuned with us because Rob Spinoza is going to be discussing this very interesting article. Audience, you're not going to want to miss this. Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hoff of Pacific Private Money and Rob Spinoza of RPM Mortgage. When we cut to the first commercial break, we ask this astronomy question. What is the name of the hazy band of light that arcs across the clear night sky?
Aurealis?
Aurora Borealis? No, Aurora. It's a Milky Way.
Milky Way!
What?
It's not a Snickers bar, it is the Milky Way. Okay.
He was going way too...
Yeah, you're going way too sophisticated. Yeah. Okay, Rob, we teased the audience with an article. We said that it'll be unbelievable.
I saw this come across my email this morning, and I couldn't help but print it out. So, the CFPB, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau...
And who are they again?
They are the...
the enemy?
Yeah. No, they are the bureau that has been basically created and appointed by the Dodd-Frank Financial Wall Street and Financial Reform Bill to oversee the financial industry, more or less. Okay, so these guys have basically unchecked power. They were created by Congress, but they are not, and Representative Jeb Hensarling has been overly vocal, or not overly vocal, but very vocal about pointing out the fact that they are exempt from basically Congress's examination. But anyway,
checks and balances.
Yeah, exactly. So they've overrun their renovation costs for their headquarters. to the tune of $65 million, okay? That puts their cost per square foot of this...
Wait, how much was it supposed to be?
It was supposed to be $120 million.
Okay, so a 50% oops.
Yeah. So what this is smacks of, to me, in the mortgage industry is, of course, the CFPB is looking at our good faith estimates, and they are requiring that there can be no changes in many of these fields. So if you have, for any reason, leaving out all, you know, anything that would be done, you know, unethically or anything like that, even in the best of situations and with the best of intentions, if you had a scenario where the price changed, you could not go back to the borrower and accommodate that. So basically,
right. They exist to protect the taxpayer.
And
what are they doing here?
They've landlocked our industry and made it so hard to get things done. All sorts of regulations, all sorts of time requirements. Lo and behold, you have them who they basically had an estimate and they overshot it by $65 million, and. Basically, nothing happens as a result.
Now, they did it, or the contractor, right? Because you said that they were.
Well, that's what's interesting about this, because it says here the Fed's Inspector General also noted that the CFPB was unable to locate any documentation of the decision to fully renovate the building. So that'd be equivalent for me of not having produced a good faith estimate for the borrower. No,
but $600 a square foot to renovate a building. I mean, I work with rehabbers making loans here in the Bay Area.
Yeah,
and it's very rare that we're making loans based on more than $200 per square foot.
Well, it says that Dubai, the equivalent Dubai's Burj Khalifa would be $450 per square foot. That's the one that Tiger Woods hit the golf ball off of. I don't know if you remember that.
That was a while ago.
Yeah.
I mean, what did they say? Like, what made it so expensive?
No, it doesn't say. Hear what
the
made
gold
it so
toilet
expensive.
Seats.
Besides incompetence.
Yeah, so it's really funny to read articles like this, and you know, I do believe that the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, the intent at the end of the day to protect the consumer, I have no problem with any of that. I have a problem with the way they've done it, and when you have them exempt from their own rules, that's pretty tough to swallow. That I mean, reading an article like this is you can joke about it, but at the end of the day. They've made it very hard for a lot of consumers to get the financing.
You will have to trust us. We watch ourselves.
Incredible.
Well, in as evidence of how the agencies like this brand new CFPB, the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau.
It's brand new?
It is brand new. It was created in the wake of the Dodd-Frank reforms.
Right, exactly.
And so as an example of how they've made it actually more difficult for the average consumer to get financing is the fact that you know, I'm a private money loan broker. Mm-hmm. I make hard money, private money loans. And the loans we're doing nowadays, in fact, 80% of our loan volume today is to consumers who've watched their purchase loan on a home that they intend to occupy fall out.
Right.
So we're doing almost every loan we're making today is to a consumer as a result of a conventional financing fallout, and the fallout's occurring because of how much more difficult it is to qualify, how many more questions they come back with, how much more paperwork you have to provide. The pendulum really, really has swung completely 180 degrees from 5 years ago.
So I kind of look at it, the two of you guys, and one guy is going, I hate these regulations, and the other guy's probably going, I love these regulations.
Well, in my heart, I hate them because I'm not a fan of government intervention in any form. I just don't. Yeah. I just don't think they're competent enough to know what to do. I always think that the capital markets, private sector, is much more competent at correcting. And in fact, we did fix ourselves after the financial meltdown. Notwithstanding what you might read in the papers, Dodd-Frank has done nothing to add value.
Well,
in my opinion. Well, I shouldn't say nothing, but let's just say nowhere near as much as some of these horn-tooting politicians need you to believe.
I think that there's good elements of Dodd-Frank, and I think that protecting the consumer, like I said, I have no issue with that. The rigidity of these guidelines makes getting even the most highly qualified borrowers through the system a challenge in some cases, and I don't like seeing that. The other thing is that we are too quick to give credit to things like this when really a huge component of both the downturn and the recovery has been the valuation of the collateral itself. So let's not forget that, you know, winning cures all ills, right? And they say in baseball, what you have with stuff like this is, you know, when the market goes the wrong way, there are a lot of guilty parties. When it turns around, it's impossible to say that Dodd-Frank did that. and that they were, you know, the way they've cleaned up the banking industry is the reason why we're back on firmer footing. It's not what I've seen.
Well, there was an unnamed mortgage company that was taking advantage of seniors. Years back.
Right.
But the solution that they came up with about you can't make them a loan unless you can show the ability to repay is a problem for people who say, listen, I'm cash poor, real
right.
estate rich.
I've got all this equity.
Yeah, I need to sell. Basically, I don't want to sell my house. In fact, that's a good example, right? Because you get some people mm-hmm. who they are paying, because of interest rates being low, their mortgage payment is fairly low. And if they were to sell their house and move it into an apartment, they'd
a lot
be paying
of
more.
To that. Right.
So,
yeah, and again, it comes back to my point about how when you put in guidelines that are this wide sweeping and this inflexible, there's a lot of fallout from that. And I don't think the CFPB will know, and they don't know now for some time, what exactly that is and how that can be sort of scaled back to accommodate more buyers, responsibly, of course, but accommodate more borrowers that should be qualified for a loan, but that are falling out. You know, the example I always give is what's a better credit risk in their eyes? Is it the person with the 42.99% debt ratio at 80% loan to value, or is it the person with the 43.1% debt ratio at 50% loan to value? You're a hard money guy. You know the answer to that.
Yeah. Number two,
right? It's number two. But number two is not qualified for a QM, a qualified mortgage. Because of the Dodd-Frank rigid guidelines of 43, hard and fast stop. You're not going to see lenders make loans beyond it.
So, Rob, you're a mortgage broker for RPM Mortgage here in the Bay Area, one of the California's leading mortgage bankers. I read a quick blurb. Nationwide, mortgage loan applications are down. Mm-hmm. And I know that we tend to like to talk about the Bay Area and California markets here. What's your pipeline looking like? Have origination requests been going down in your market?
Well, what I've seen on the purchase side, it's been robust, but that requires a lot of work. It requires a lot of local realtor relationships. So I think that has insulated me a bit from what maybe the national industry standard has been on that. On the refinance side, what you don't see a whole lot of activity these days. A lot of the borrowers that have been left standing already have taken advantage of rates that were available last year.
Right.
And about a full percent lower than what's available now, sometimes only a half percent. But you are able to pick some of them up on especially favorable market days. And that's what I've seen lately. That's been the tune for the second part of, the second quarter of 2014. I don't think my pipeline jibes with the national stats. But applications have been down, and there are certainly a lot of loan officers who are feeling that.
Okay, tell you what, we're going to cut to our second commercial break, and when we come back, we had some very interesting emails for our co-hosts here. All right, theme is astronomy. What do we call a compact, star-like, celestial body with a power output greater than our entire galaxy? Okay, and it's believed to be the oldest and most distant objects ever detected. They are billions of light years from Earth and moving away from us at nearly 80% of the speed of light.
I feel like I should be doing the Dr. Evil
thing.
billions,
yes. And a hint, the answer is not black holes.
Okay, got it.
What do we call a compact, star-like, celestial body with a power output greater than our entire galaxy, believed to be the oldest and most distant objects ever detected? They are billions of light years from Earth and moving away from us at nearly 80% the speed of light. That's about how fast you drive, isn't it, Rob?
Yeah, only when I'm texting.
Oh, yeah. All right, that's that dial. Oh, we're having too much fun here. The Best of Investing will be right back. Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hoff and Rob Spinoza. When we cut to the second commercial break, we ask this trivia question. What do we call a compact, star-like, celestial body with a power output greater than our entire galaxy, believed to be the oldest and most distant objects ever detected? They are billions of light years from Earth and moving away from us at nearly 80% of the speed of light. Mark thinks he has the answer because he's out of this world.
Well, and I just like this word. Is it a quark?
No, but you're close.
Oh.
It's a quasar.
Oh, wow.
Very,
Oh, you know what? I that's think the quark good. Is like the tiny little object.
Maybe. Yeah, that's
is that what it is?
Subatomic
okay.
part.
Yeah, subatomic. Okay, wait, I mixed
it,
up my
it, it still starts with a Q. It starts with a Q, though, right? Okay. We'll give you no credit. We'll give you no credit.
I was gonna say white dwarf.
White dwarf.
Yeah,
no.
All right.
No, that was one of Snow White's favorite.
Red dwarfs.
Okay, so before we get into email, next week we're gonna have a special trivia contest. Email time. Mark, where are you finding your best loans?
Well, if you'd asked me that 2 years ago, and just again for the audience, I'm Mark Hahn. I'm a broker for Pacific Private Money. We're a private money loan broker. It used to be called hard money, but I kind of prefer the private money term these days. And we do so because the industry's really changed a lot. I mean, we are regulated now. It used to be a Wild West type of lender of last resort 10, 15, 20 years ago. But over the, pretty much since 2008, private money loan companies like Pacific Private Money have sprouted up to provide financing for a rather large and growing segment of the lending populace who no longer qualified for bank financing. Now, initially, most of the loans we were doing were to real estate investors who found they could no longer go to the bank and borrow money to buy a house that they were going to fix and flip. And so a lot of the foreclosure activity that went on in 2009, 10, 11, 12 was financed largely through private capital, through private money loan brokers like Pacific. Now, today, interestingly enough, here we are in the summer of 2014, and the fix and flip activity has decreased dramatically, and in large part.
Yeah, why is that?
Well, in large part because there isn't as much foreclosure activity out there. The it's mostly been snapped up. You've probably heard of some of these large hedge fund based organizations that have snapped up properties by the tens of thousands.
Well that's what Warren Buffett said he'd love to do if he could figure out a way to manage it.
Right,
exactly. And he said that over a year ago. So nowadays there's just really not. I mean, you could still find opportunities. You can always find opportunities to invest in real estate today, but it's just not as the unit sales are down for investors, and quite frankly, there's more competition. There's actually more lenders out there like Pacific that have sprouted up over the last few years. So I'm finding that there's a lot more competition. So the answer to the question is, where are we finding our best loan deals? Really today, this has to go back to what we talked about in the last segment, is that escrows that are falling out conventionally, where the buyer still wants to buy that house, but now he no longer qualifies for bank financing, or the bank is not going to be able to close in time.
Right.
So, for example, I'm working on a deal right now where I got a call from a mortgage broker who said, I have a client who's putting 45% down and needs a 55% loan to purchase price loan, but she put a 20-day close on the purchase contract so that she could get
the property,
because there was competition to get this property. Yeah. She had to go over asking about 15%. It's a San Francisco purchase, and she needs to close by mid next week.
Right, and you got the holiday in there, so it's actually less than 20 days.
So the mortgage broker tells me, I can have her conventionally refied in 30 days, but I need you, Mark, to come in with a private money loan to close quickly so she can get this property. It's a great opportunity for her. So that's typical. And other examples of so-called bridge loans, bridge meaning a temporary loan that we've done for homeowners lately, have been maybe where the mortgage broker thought they were bank financeable, but the banks right now, as you know, Rob, they ask more questions and more questions and more questions, and where you initially thought they were pre-qualified to get a loan.
Right, now you've uncovered something.
Now you've uncovered something that maybe, like for example, we did a loan for one person who is a self-employed business owner, has multiple business accounts, and the bank just got caught up with this issue of him having multiple accounts instead of one personal account where all the money was sitting, and that stalled his ability to close. And so we came in and made him a short-term loan to close.
One thing I have to disagree with you, though. You say that there's competition. There is no competition. You are the man.
That's a ringing endorsement.
Well, we do have a great reputation.
Yeah,
I got to pat myself a little on the back. We do have a great reputation. I've got a great staff.
You answer the phone.
We have about as close as to 100% delivery rate as you can achieve in this business, in terms of if someone calls us and tells a scenario over the phone, we can green light that relatively quickly, sometimes within a couple of hours. And once we've green lighted a deal, we've just never failed to deliver. We've got so many sources and resources for capital. We have our mortgage pool fund, and we've got individuals who also like to invest in trust deeds. We have so much capital looking to deploy that if we green light a loan, and we're pretty experienced at this, and we know the Bay Area really, really well, we can react quickly. And so, you know, we're good at operating within, sometimes within a 72-hour time period to close a deal.
For the listening audience, I know we've had a lot of listeners who have been with us for years and have heard this, but we've been getting a lot of new listeners too. What kind of rates are you charging on average to your borrowers?
Between 8.9, call it 9%, and 10%. We usually, you know, price it at 8.9 to 9.9. That's typical private money pricing. Again, it's intended to be short term. It's not intended to be a 5-year loan or an alternative necessarily to bank financing. We're really there to be kind of the guy that comes in and helps you when there's a problem or a stutter step. It's not intended to be long-term financing. So,
well, I'll put that in perspective too, because even our most accommodating programs on the conventional side, if you start going out of the realm of the QM stuff, that stuff starts pricing in the high fours and low fives. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, if you're going out to private money and you're getting rid of the 30-day time window and all that other stuff, that's putting it right in there. I mean, it's not unreasonable.
It's a means to an end, and our qualification process is... it's night and day with the bank. It's really, we don't look at the same things, and qualifying can happen relatively quickly. And again, we're mostly looking at the collateral.
Yeah.
And so, and since we don't typically go over 70% loan to value, we can, you know, usually feel pretty secure.
And the, you mentioned that you have a fund and individual investors. What kind of yield can those investors get?
So we're paying an annualized return of 8.5% on our mortgage pool fund now, and that's available to accredited investors anywhere in California. In fact, we can accept investors all over the U.S. An accredited investor is someone who has a net worth of $1 million or more, not including the equity in their home.
Right.
Now, that's a SEC, Securities and Exchange Commission definition. That's not our definition, but that's one of the qualification necessary to invest in the fund. But we've got over 50 investors in the fund to date, and we're producing 8.5% return, largely by making these short-term loans on well-secured properties with great borrowers. I mean, most of our borrowers have incredible credit scores.
And correct me if I'm wrong, you also have an income requirement for the accredited investor, too.
So no, it's either or.
Either or, right.
Yeah, if you're making more than $200,000 a year as a single person, you're considered an accredited investor. Or if you have
net worth of
more than $1 million.
Okay, we're going to cut to our third commercial final break. When we come back, we have an interesting question for Rob about real estate taxes and refinancing.
Great.
So I know a lot of people have that kind of question, so that'll be very good.
Okay, here is the last astronomy question. If a massive star explodes, it may become very bright. What do we call one of these mass explosions? All right. Don't touch that dial. The Best of Investing. We'll be right back. Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host. Just last time for the show. My co-hosts, Mark Hunt of Pacific Private Money and Rob Spinoza of RPM Mortgage. When we get to the third commercial break, we ask this trivia question. If a massive star explodes, it may become very bright. What do we call one of these mass explosions?
A supernova.
A Chevy Nova. A supernova. That is correct. Email question here for Rob. And it is, if I continue to run as fast as you do, will I be as good looking as you? Okay. Rob is you're one of those
triathletes.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank
are you.
You
are you an ultra triathlete? Or just a regular
I'm an Ironman distance triathlete.
A regular old Ironman.
Garden variety Ironman. Right.
A Robert Downey Jr. kind.
Okay.
Here's a trivia question for you. God, why am I keep saying that trivia question? It's an email.
That's
question.
That's all right. I'll make a trivia question.
Okay.
Who is?
Yeah. This is Jeopardy. Will my property taxes go up if I refinance? I bet you get that question a lot.
I get it a lot. I've even had people tell me they held off on asking about refinancing even though they saw rates were lower because they thought their property taxes were going to go up. So, by and large, the answer is no. Your property taxes will not go up simply by refinancing. When you buy a home, you have a transfer of title, and that's what triggers the reassessment. So, you, for example, here in Marin, you've got someone who bought the house in 1960, and now their tax, you know, they're paying $2,000 a year. If you were to go and buy that house from them for $1.5 million, your taxes would be a lot more than
$15,000.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So that happens because the title is transferring from the seller to the buyer. When you refinance, you're already on title, and you will, in the vast majority of cases, not see an increase in your property taxes. So you don't have to be afraid of that. There are a couple of things to keep in mind with property taxes, though. And when you have a refinance, if the area is being reassessed anyway, you may see a tax increase through that, but that's not directly tied to the refinance.
Okay, because yeah, that's my question. Let's say that you had a house that was worth a lot, you purchased it in 2005 at the height of the market, let's say. So it drops. Now you've got your Prop 8 adjustment, so that it's lower. And now, or let's say you want to get it lower.
You appeal.
And does the tax assessor say, by the way, have you refinanced lately? Let me see the appraisal.
No. I have not seen that happen. Okay. The other thing is, though, but you bring up a really good point, because I just got letters from our assessor here in Marin about the fact that they're now readjusting that back. One property went down, the other one went up. So that is something to be aware of. It's independent of the refinance, though.
So they don't ask you that at all? When you're trying to appeal real estate taxes, they don't ask, you know, have you refinanced? Are you planning on refinancing?
I have not appealed that. I've just gotten the notices with the trend in the area. So I'd have to research that for you. I don't know offhand how that works.
Okay, because I guess in theory they could pull their own appraisal.
Yeah, and that is a good point, though, because we often encounter that. The assessed value is very different than your appraised value. So, you know, if you went and got an appraisal on a property, it might be $750,000, and the assessor's office may have that property assessed at $430,000. So your taxes are based off of the assessed value, of course. So it's not a direct correlation. It's very hard to know one from the other.
I tell you, in Berkeley, it's nauseating because what they do is sometimes you'll look and you go, hey, that's great, man. They're giving me a really low base. But when you start adding all of the other stuff in, it's like, you know, I don't care that you said my $1 million property is worth $100,000.
Right.
I'm paying property taxes as though it's worth $3 million add up everything.
Yeah, it's very interesting, too, because we talk about this, the property tax equation. I just got an article here, and it's talking about how property tax hikes. We don't really see hikes, but once you own the property here because of Prop 13, but I'm sure nationwide, if you have an increase in your property taxes, it could conceivably affect your ability to qualify for a loan.
Yeah, that's important.
Yeah, we were just talking about the hard and fast rules from Dodd-Frank, and if your property taxes are going up, that's happening beyond your control, but it is happening to something that is that controls you, and that's your qualification. So that's something to be aware of. I also think it's worth mentioning for first-time home buyers that may be listening. When you rent a property, obviously you're just paying your rent, but when you purchase a home, you've got your principal and interest on your mortgage payment and your property taxes.
And insurance.
And insurance. And there's two ways to pay property taxes and insurance. You can either pay them with your mortgage payment, you can escrow them, so they'll take 1/12 of that and add it to your payment, or you can pay them on your own here in California. So just be aware of that when you're first
time. Some lenders require it, don't they?
Well, FHA loans require it, and if your loan-to-value exceeds 89.99%, so if you basically
have mortgage insurance, too.
Well, you'd have mortgage insurance, but they would also, many lenders here in California, once your LTV, your loan-to-value is 90%, then they require impounds, because it's technically a riskier loan for the lender, and they want to know they have control over your property tax payment, because that would become a lien on your title that would supersede the mortgage on your
side. If I were them, I would do the same thing. Right. Mark, do you ever do that? Impound?
We're required to now on all first position loans.
Really?
For consumer purpose. Yeah, we're actually now required to collect payments that are PITI, principal, interest,
I didn't know
taxes,
that.
And insurance. So that's one of the new Dodd-Frank requirements that...
Well, you're just like the bank.
Well, you know...
Just like the bank, so we don't like to do it.
Neither does your consumer.
Yeah, but actually, I mean, you don't like it because it's administrative hassle. But the thing is, but it does actually make it a little bit safer, because then you know for sure the tax is
being
paid.
Right. And the home's insured, which is not insignificant either. I mean, you know, in the case that a homeowner would drop the insurance.
Well, yeah, but usually what happens in that case, if the homeowner drops the insurance, what ends up happening is the lender gives them time to
force place it.
Yeah, exactly. That's usually a little more expensive. So that gets you right. In fact,
that's right. Well, you know what's funny about this too, because I used to do loans in all 50 states when I worked for Flagstar Bank. We could originate throughout the country. Most of the country, it is commonplace to have an escrow account. So outside of California, most people pay property or principal interest taxes and insurance every month. Here in California, just the opposite. Most people do not.
Because we're more responsible here in California.
Of course. and better looking.
That's right. So if getting back, if you want to be as good looking as Rob, how do they get a hold of you?
Well, I don't know about that, but I'll give you my contact information. I work for the Mill Valley branch of RPM Mortgage. My bio's on the Best of Investing website, too.
And you go pleasure. There and you can see how good looking he is.
Pleasure to be here, even at the salary you're paying.
Hey, it's about my pay. All right, guys. Hey, before we get into our thoughts for the day, you got 45 seconds.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Well, just, you know, talking about the PITI, it's interesting that one of the reasons why Dodd-Frank's, among all the laws they passed, were to say now as a lender you have to collect a payment for taxes and insurance in addition to principal and interest, is they included that under their anti-predatory lending laws. In other words, they consider an interest-only loan to be predatory lending. Now, that being said, we still do interest-only loans on investment properties and on short-term bridge loans. So again, it just depends on the type of loan product it is.
Okay, guys, here's our thoughts for the day. Get this. In the 1980s, Pablo Escobar's Medellin cartel was spending $2,500 a month on rubber bands just to hold the
cash.
Isn't that amazing? Okay, and I was just going to say, I wonder if it was tax deductible. Probably, if you're claiming the income. Okay, ordinary and necessary. Yeah, that's necessary for sure. Okay, and when the mummy of Ramses II was sent to France in the mid-1970s, it was issued a passport. Ramses' occupation? King. Deceased. All right, tune in next week to The Best of Investing. We're going to be giving away 9 more free vacations for answering trivia questions. Don't do that. Thanks for listening on behalf of our team.
Now that we have your attention.
Yes. I'm Edward Brown, wishing you the best of investing. So long. Today's trivia theme is old U.S. history. Now, quick correction from last week. Last week we had a Clint Eastwood question where I thought the answer was that he used a 357 Magnum in Dirty Harry. Turns out he used a 44 Magnum.
Oh.
And I got a correction from a listener on that. Thank you, Mr. Listener. Okay, our website is bestofinvesting.com. Check us out on Facebook and YouTube by typing Best of Investing Radio Show. By the way, that's the first time I ever made that mistake. I'm allowed
in
one.
In 4 years?
In 4 years. Well, one in 4 years, that's not too bad. Every 4 years I'll make that mistake. Okay, we're also on television, Comcast, Channel 26, and AT&T, Channel 99, Saturdays at noon, Sundays at 6 p.m. Catherine Harris, you have some interesting articles for us.
Well, every once in a while, I have to have a soapbox. I just have to stand on it, and I just got to take the opportunity. So today's the opportunity. You're welcome. it's planning for your future. It's a couple of things that you can do using pre-tax dollars, after-tax dollars that people need to do or think about planning for the next year, planning for your children, planning for your retirement. Couple things. And some of these things aren't going to be applicable to everybody. Some are going to be things that you have to have income limits. Others, because you may have higher income limits, you are limited in some areas, that you should actually think of these ones where you should actually maybe go to your CPA or go with your tax advisor or whoever you work with. Maybe even to your HR and say, hey, what are some of these options that I have for that I could have
if my income?
I'm excited. So a couple pre-tax items is dependent care or a flexible savings account that you can have with your employer. Okay. You can use pre-tax dollars to pay for dependent care. I have 2 children, a 6-year-old and a 2-year-old. I swear half my check goes to rent and the other half goes to dependent care.
How come the 6-year-old doesn't take care of the 2-year-old?
I wish,
okay.
She does for the 5 minutes I walk away, but okay. I don't think I legally can.
Yeah, that'd be a little tough.
I think I can wait till she's about 8, then I can do it, right?
That's right.
But you can use, and it's not just pre-tax income tax, it's pre-tax social and Medicare tax.
That's pretty major, because that off the top is what, around 8% roughly?
Exactly. It's state tax, so it's state, federal, and those two taxes. Same thing for flexible savings account. A flexible savings account is one where you can put pre-tax dollars, again, pre-income and pre-Medicare, Social Security, away to pay for out-of-pocket medical expenses. So this is when you go to the dentist or you go to the eye doctor for those. Even if you go to your normal doctor and you have a deductible or a copay and you don't pay through another means that's pre-tax, this is pre-tax.
Now, do these have to be set up by your employer? Are these part of your paycheck deductions?
Now, this one is one where this is a paycheck deduction. So this one
the
you do have to go.
The flexible savings plan for dependent care.
And for dependent care. But these are ones where usually you don't have to have an income limit. So oftentimes where you get hit on your tax return when you come down, like, well, why don't I get this deduction? Why don't I get, often you do, when you do your tax return, have the capability of deducting dependent care costs, but there's an income limit threshold there. Generally speaking, there's not on the other end. So speak with your HR department.
Because you can't do you can't do that on your own. Right?
You can't
do
that.
You have to do it through your employer.
You do have to do that one through your employer, exactly.
Okay. What if you are the employer? So
you set that puppy up.
Yeah, exactly. In fact, Mark, it's so exciting. You and Lisa should start having more kids just for that. Just for that by itself.
That horse has left the barn.
Okay, so now, and that's an FSA.
That's an FSA.
There's an MSA, right? There's an HSA.
HSA, and yep, HSA is a fantastic one where it's a kind of a take on an FSA because it actually is tied to a health plan.
Okay.
And where you get to put pre-tax dollars. So the caveat with an FSA is one where you have to have some planning involved. You have to, one, your employer has to offer it. Two, at the beginning of the year is when you have to go to your employer and they give you the option to set it up and you decide how much you want to put away or save for that. If you don't use that money by the end of the year, you do lose it. But
yeah, see, and that's the thing. Now, see, an HSA just keeps growing like an IRA, but it's not pre-FICA.
It is pre-FICA. It's not in California, it's not, the state of California doesn't recognize HSA. I think it's pre-FICA, I thought, but maybe not.
I don't think so, but let's put it this way. Me being self-employed, it doesn't affect my Social Security tax on my tax return. The 1 year they did allow it, but I think they took that away. Yeah, boy.
I got an HSA and it's great. I don't know if it's pre or post FICA, and quite frankly, I don't care right now. I just know I like it.
Because you're building, you can use it for your medical expenses, and if you don't, it's just like a big IRA, and it's an above the line deduction.
Exactly, and there is a limit in it, but there's no limit that comes to there's no income limit that prohibits you from being pre-tax, at least for income tax purposes. The other one is a Roth IRA. Again, that one does have some income limits, but it's one that is if people are looking for if they have some extra cash on the other side.
Yep.
After-tax savings rather than pre-tax saving, a Roth IRA is a fantastic, fantastic vehicle.
This is me being a little pessimistic, is I've always thought...
Poop on the parade.
Poop on the parade, yeah. My prediction, and I could be wrong, but my prediction is that if you have too much money in a Roth IRA, and they may do this for regular IRAs too, but a Roth IRA, which is the after-tax, because you don't get a deduction for the Roth IRA,
But it
grows tax-free is that eventually when either you are going to collect on Social Security or somehow the government's going to look and they're going to see there's too much money in the Roth IRA and they want to get their hands on some of that.
When that number gets to 20 trillion, they're just going to go, that's criminal.
We're going to change the rules just like they did with Social Security, right? And then now they've raised it to 67, I think, is the... the retirement age for maximum, for the minimum of full benefits type of thing. And eventually that'll go to 70 and 120 and, nobody will get Social Security.
None of us can plan for the future or know that far into advance what the federal government's going to do when it comes to taxes.
Sure.
This is just one where I've had clients come to me and just say, I have extra cash.
Yeah,
that's after tax. What do I do?
Yeah.
And that is just an option. It's a great option, especially if you make less than, I think it's $190, give or take, where you can put away Roth IRA.
So, Catherine, I have...
Did you raise your hand?
Yes, I did.
Yes, he did, because he wants,
like
to,
a good
he wants to speak.
Yes.
Mark,
yes,
I choose
school did
you.
Start today, yes.
It's your turn.
School did, yep.
And
school started for my daughter.
Did you have to go to the bathroom? Was that why you raised your hand? No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So, I have a daughter in college, and it's not an inexpensive one here in California. Is there a savings plan that I can participate in that would help defray the fact that, you know, if I do nothing, I'm paying with after-tax dollars her
tuition.
Her tuition.
Does she work at all?
She does have a job, yes.
If she works enough, she could almost... Usually when they're in college, it's a little harder, mm-hmm. Just because at that point in time, the opportunity to accumulate a lot of pre-tax savings is has kind of... You've missed the boat there. But depending on your income level and her income level and what she does for a living, who gets the credits, the college credits? You can get up to, I think, 2,000, maybe 2,500 in tax credits to offset the cost of tuition. Oh. That's not a whole lot, but it's something.
Maybe
I'll
it's
take.
Every little bit.
So it sounds like I should talk to my CPA.
You should talk to your CPA, yes.
Always.
Especially when you're not sure something, especially if you're kind of, you know, you're kind of near a limit.
Yeah.
You're teeter-tottering on certain transactions.
Yeah, because you can push income to the next year, potentially. Okay, I tell you what, we're going to cut to a first commercial break here. Again, the theme is old U.S. history. Here's the question. Which president drafted the Bill of Rights? And it was not Bill Clinton, just because his name is in there, okay? When you call 888-912-1190, you're going to give us your email, spell it out, and say it slowly, please. Again, to answer this question, which president drafted the Bill of Rights? Don't touch that dial. The Best of Investing will be right back. We can. Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hahn, president of Pacific Private Money, and Catherine Harris, CPA of Parati & Karat. When we cut to the first commercial break, we ask this trivia question. Which president drafted the Bill of Rights?
Taft. I always say Taft.
Did you always say Taft?
President question.
No, it's which president?
He did something, right?
Yeah, well, he weighed the most. He weighed over 300 pounds.
There you go.
I think he threw out the first baseball, I think. you have to go back just a little further than that.
I don't know.
Was it Adams?
Just two presidents after him.
Really? You know the order of the presidents?
Well, yeah. You had Washington, Adams, Jefferson, Madison, Monroe.
Keep on going.
Adams,
did we pass it
Martin Van Buren. Jackson.
Me.
He's in there somewhere. And Polk.
Stonewall.
He's one of those guys nobody even know. Or Franklin Pierce. Did anyone even know he was a president?
No.
Okay. James Madison.
Okay.
He actually drafted it. Were you finished, Catherine? Or did you want to...
We can hop on that later on.
Until later on. Okay.
Absolutely. So I've got an article that should be of interest to people who are trying to get bank financing. There's a certain segment of the population that have been trying to get bank loans lately in this post-financial crash market. And that is that a little company called Fair Isaac came up with a credit scoring model called FICO. Well, they've changed their name now to FICO, so the company name is now no longer Fair Isaac, but credit giant FICO. And they just announced that they're making some changes to their scoring algorithm this fall. And what they've done is they're going to ignore certain types of collection accounts when the underlying debt has been paid off. And as you know, as time marches on after you've had what they call a derogatory, they tend to drop off. So they're going to accelerate that, again, for certain types of collection accounts, which they don't go into. But they do go into another certain type, and that is medical collection accounts. And I'll tell you that as a hard money loan broker, when I'm looking at credit scores and credit reports, I love it when the major items that are derogatory on a credit report are medical collections, because those, in my opinion, typically are great borrowers. And
why is that?
Well, look, it's not uncommon for someone whose credit otherwise is perfect to have credit collection issues, and it revolves around the fact that oftentimes people aren't properly insured when a major medical event happens. Yeah. And it's not unusual for someone to be saddled with tens, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars of medical debt. And as those things age and as they don't pay them off, unfortunately, hospitals and other medical collection companies have this tendency of putting that on their collection report as a derogatory. I mean, it's really the only leverage they have. Either you pay this, or we're going to report to the credit bureaus.
Yep.
And so they're going to give that lesser weight, which is good. So they're thinking that some people could see their scores go up as much as 25 points as a result of this new scoring model.
Well, that's good, but for you though, as a lender who lends more for equity. You know what I'm thinking, right? Is the average borrower, it's good for them because when they go to the bank's going to go, oh, your credit score is fine, whereas ordinarily it would have been lower because of that. And
this is irrelevant to the private lending and the hard money lending model.
Okay.
Yeah, because again, we aren't score based as much as
my point is that those people who ordinarily couldn't get a loan from the bank because their score was too low, now their score is going to be higher and they will be able to get that bank loan.
Possibly. The banks may also just adjust for this, and what used to be the requirement to get a loan was a score of 720 or whatever it was. It's going to now be incrementally
740 or
exactly
something like that.
Exactly.
Well, that kind of defeats the purpose of having the change. You know, good news, people.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, we've raised the score minimum from 680 to 700,
wow,
which might happen. Although we talked about last week how they're actually lowering the threshold for scores on certain types of products. In fact, Wells Fargo announced that they were now dropping from 720 to 700 for some of their popular loan products.
That's pretty major.
But as Catherine pointed out, they do say that lenders actually do have multiple scoring models they can use. Not everyone uses FICO as their primary, so oftentimes you get like a tri-merge, so you get three different scores. They take the average of those three, or the middle score, for example. So the report does suggest that it's possible that they won't necessarily jump on the new credit scoring bandwagon right away. And what's interesting about this, and this is kind of comes back to the real estate side of things, which we of course talk about quite a bit on this show, and that is, well, if you're going to give a pass for people with unpaid medical bills because of a unexpected, non-recurring catastrophe,
yeah,
why would you not then consider giving that same treatment to people who suffered from a once-in-a-generation financial catastrophe and as a result had maybe a foreclosure or a short sale because of this unprecedented real estate and financial meltdown? So one could make an argument that, you know, those of us who can't get bank loans because we haven't had 7 years haven't gone by since one or more foreclosures on real estate investments that we had, we're still not considered bank financeable. Is that fair?
Well, I'm going to guess that what their attitude would be, you can't really control your health unless it's, of course, something. Let's say if you're 500 pounds. And
can you control the real estate market dropping 50%?
No, you can only that's true. You can't control that. But what you can control is how you handle it financially. Maybe, you know what I mean? Like either you over leverage yourself to begin with in purchasing, unwisely.
Dude, you're supposed to back me up.
Your
point is well taken.
I'm not saying what I would do.
It is something that was right. It was a decision. It was a credit decision that was made. The scoring models reflect that. If you have a foreclosure, they use that as the scoring model is supposed to be a predictor of future behavior. So the argument is, if you had foreclosures as a result of a major market correction, is that necessarily an accurate predictor of a future financial behavior that would impede my creditworthiness?
Because you get in a car accident and suddenly your medical bill is $1 million and you just have no way of paying that off. That's completely out of your hands.
Yep.
Exactly.
Yep, that's right.
Okay. Tell you what, can you hold that thought?
I can.
You can, okay. And I thought when my FICO score was 92, that was good because that meant I had 92%, but that's not very good. Okay. All right, here's our second commercial break. Again, the theme is old U.S. history. This is going back to Mark's time. In 1803, we see Catherine.
Taft.
Taft. I don't think Taft was born then. Okay, this is an easy one. In 1803, Thomas Jefferson paid $15 million for what? And it's not his earrings for his wife. The first three callers with the correct answer win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Call. See, you gotta, you're smiling. You're shaking your head yes. You think you know the answer to this one? Well, Taft was pretty big, so maybe it was an overcoat for him that cost $15 million. Okay. Call 888-912-1190. That's 888-912-1190 to answer this question. In 1803, Thomas Jefferson paid $15 million for what? All right, make sure to include your name and your email address. Speak slowly. Spell out your email one letter at a time. Don't touch that dial. The Best of Investing will be right back with some very interesting emails.
The Eiffel Tower.
Well, welcome back to...
Sorry.
Catherine, you're making me laugh. Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hoff and Catherine Harris, the comedian here. No, when we cut to the second commercial break,
it's impossible. I'm a CPA.
That's true. Yeah, no, CPAs can sometimes be funny. I know a couple of CPAs.
There's a few.
Jokes. There are a few. Second trivia question. In 1803, Thomas Jefferson paid $15 million for what? Catherine?
Well, I just joked and said the Eiffel Tower, but I know that's not true.
That's not true.
Is it Louisiana Purchase?
Yes, it was the Louisiana Purchase.
That's the name.
Yes.
I actually have a name right
given
too.
To us by false.
Yes. This is the Statue of Liberty. Oh my God, Statue of Liberty. Is that what you just said?
That's right. Okay, there we go. The statue, you're right, in 1885, but that's right, the Eiffel Tower. They didn't give it to us. It's still at Paris.
Yes.
I took it back.
You know what? They should have given it to us after we saved their tushies in World War II. Okay, well, that's for another show.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm sorry. Again, too much fun on this show. I think it's we're all tired, but maybe just you two are tired, right?
We're just losing our minds.
Just losing our minds. Okay, Mark, here's an email we received for you. Mm-hmm. Why do you sometimes have prepayment penalties on your loans?
Well, good question. So at Pacific Private Money, we are in the business of originating loans for, well, it used to be only real estate investors, but actually we're doing consumer loans now too. So essentially, we are like the new subprime in the lending world, since the banks really aren't serving that niche product any longer. So we make loans that the banks don't make. That's essentially what the private money lending industry today exists to do. It's not like the hard money lending industry from 10 years ago or 15 years ago. It's really it's a new industry. It's a regulated industry, and again, it's there to basically pick up the slack, you know, because the banks really are very stringent. There's a lot of loans they don't like to make these days. So question being, you know, on the loans that we make that are privately funded, sometimes they have prepayment penalties. And why is that? Well, it depends on the source of the funds that we use to make that loan. So at Pacific Private Money, we have two funding sources. One is our mortgage pool fund, and that our mortgage pool fund is a collection of, it's a like a mutual fund of mortgage secured notes. The monies come from private individuals who want to make 8% or more on their money, and are not interested in investing in an individual note. They would rather be part of a pool and have the safety of diversification. So we've got close to $7 million in our fund as of this month. And so when we make loans using our mortgage pool fund, we don't have a prepayment penalty. So if we make a loan and you pay us back in 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, and some people do. Some people have a short-term need for money, for example, to close a real estate transaction where their bank all of a sudden told them, hey, we need another 2 weeks or 30 days, or we found a glitch in your credit or a lien that you got to pay off, or any number of 100 different scenarios where you might be ready to close a real estate transaction only to find out that your bank financing glitched.
Here's our thoughts for the day. When Twister was first introduced in 1966, which I remember that, it was denounced by critics as, quote, sex in a box. Because it was like a little bit too topsy-turvy. Okay, and get this. You ready for this?
They had some interesting sex life.
Yes, yeah, really. And O.J. Simpson was originally cast to play the Terminator, but the studio was afraid that no one would buy him as a remorseless killer. Isn't that wild? All right, tune in next week to The Best of Investing. We're going to be giving away how many? 9 more free vacations for answering trivia questions. Thanks for listening. On behalf of our team, I'm your host, Edward Brown. We'll see you next week.